hear a show tune from the Great White Way, does a shiver run through ya? Well, we're giving them to ya. Sing hallelujah and shout hooray. Come on along and listen to Broadway to Main Street.
And the clouds will roll away today on Broadway to Main Street. This is Larry Mazlon, your host for that self-same show here at 88.3 FM, Peconic Public Broadcasting, emanating out of the summertime hamlet of Southampton. Well, today we have a real surprise. I think it's a great, great hour of music. Bill Charlap, he and his trio have been the most dominant piano personalities when it comes to the American Songbook. They're about to do a two-week residency at Jazz in July at the 92nd Street Y. And I interviewed Bill all the way over the miracles of modern science from a gig he was playing in Vienna. So we're just going to take it away, and you'll hear this great conversation between me and Bill, and even better, his music. So today we're sort of Broadway to the Kärntnerstrasse. We have Bill Charlap, who has done more good work for the Broadway Songbook than any pianist since the days of Oscar Peterson and Bill Evans. And we play him frequently, and we're thrilled to have you on Broadway to Main Street, Bill.
I'm thrilled to be here with you.
Now, the main event coming up for you and for all those lucky New Yorkers is Jazz in July at the 92nd Street Y, which are six concerts between July 16th and 25th. And if I'm correct, you're not only how many of them are you playing in?
Well, I play on all of them.
Wow. And you're also the artistic director.
I'm also the artistic director and pretty much your host.
Oh, great. Well, nobody could be better than that. So, Bill, one thing that I'm always attracted to, because in our show we play a lot of Broadway songs, obviously, or stuff that originated on the Broadway stage, is how much attention you've given within the American Songbook playbook, as it were, to stuff from Broadway. But, of course, it makes sense because Broadway is in your blood, isn't it?
That's true. My father was Moose Charlap, who was a great theater composer, most famous for most of the songs for the Mary Martin Peter Pan. And My mother is Sandy Stewart, who is a wonderful pop singer of her generation. That is a singer of popular songs from the canon of the great American songwriters, who swings and sang with Benny Goodman and was a regular on Barry Como and Mitch Miller, and she's just a marvelous singer, and she comes from that aesthetic also.
Well, Sandy Stewart is also a great contributor to the American and Broadway songbook, and she made a terrific album with Dick Hyman, who's also your predecessor in terms of the 92nd Street Y Jazz in July series. Do you want to talk a little about that Kern album?
Well, sure, and he's also a distant cousin on my father's side, and Dick Hyman has been, more than any other musician, such a generous mentor to me and generous friend over the years. I've known him since I was in my early teens, and he took me around to record dates and symphonic dates, film dates, jazz concerts, ballet music, all kinds of things where I was a fly on the wall watching and witnessing this pro of pros. And it was Dick Hyman's series, Jazz in July, for 20 years before I took over, so he's really been a very, very important friend to me. Anyway, that album of Jerome Kern songs is an album of duets of Dick Hyman at the piano, my mother singing. And I learned pretty much all of those songs in terms of really learning them, learning the lyrics and learning the structure of them from that album. And boy, I really think it's a masterpiece of an album. It's kind of unclassifiable exactly what it is, because I would say it's not quite a jazz album. It's not quite just a songbook album. It's not a theater album. It's not a cabaret album. It's just a meeting of the minds of two magnificent musicians singing the music that is, well, the composer that I've called many times the angel at the top of the tree of the great theater writers, Jerome Kern. And incidentally, not to get ahead of ourselves, but of course I made an album with Tony Bennett, which was a collaborative album called The Silver Lining, all Jerome Kern songs. And that was kind of a bit full circle for me, because I grew up on those songs with my mother and Dick Hyman. And then to record those songs with Tony Bennett, and also with my trio of 22 years, Kenny Washington and Peter Washington, and also with my wife, Rini Rosnes. Some of the tracks are two piano tracks, so that's enough information.
Well, it's a brilliant album, and let's tee up our bookend. We're going to hear a song written for the film A Showboat, Nobody Else But Me.
I want to be no one but me. I am in love with a lover who likes me the way I am. I have my faults. He likes my faults. I'm not very bright. He's not very bright. He thinks I'm grand. That's grand for me. He may be wrong, but if we get along, what do we care, say we? When he holds me close, close as we can be, I tell the lad that I'm grateful and I'm glad that I'm nobody else but me. A lover who likes me the way I am. I have my faults. He likes my faults. I'm not very bright. He's not very bright. He thinks I'm grand. That's grand for me. He may be wrong, but if we get along, what do we care? Say we. Walking on the shore, swimming in the sea. When I'm with him, I'm glad the girl who's with him is nobody else but me.
Sandy Stewart, Dick Hyman, Jerome Kern. What a great album. Now, Bill Charlap talks a little bit about the great composers of the American Songbook, and we'll hear two classics, both Hill songs, after that.
You've recorded so much from the American Songbook. Clearly you love it. As we said, clearly it's in your blood. Do you find that there's a significant difference between those songs written for the musical theater stage, for theater performances, in terms of context or depth of lyrics? Because for a pianist who doesn't sing, you understand lyrics better than many singers do.
Well, I care about the lyrics. I feel that they are indeed 50-50. It's an exact relationship to each other. So they're just as important. Alec Wilder felt that the songs for the theater were generally of a higher quality most of the time. And I think that the theater writers in general had the major discipline of writing for the theater, creating songs that would work within the context of musical theater, but also would transcend the musical theater. So I think in a way, certainly the great Mount Rushmore of American theater writers, whom I consider to be Jerome Kern, Irving Berlin, George Gershwin, Cole Porter, Richard Rodgers, and Harold Arlen, because they're the most prolific and the most innovative. But that's not to negate non-theater writers like Duke Ellington or Hoagy Carmichael or popular songs that were outside of the theater. There are some very great popular songs that are not necessarily theater music, but by and large, some of the best come from the theater writers, that's for sure. Thank you.
with lofty aims strive for lofty goals. Others play at smaller games, being simpler souls. I am of the latter brand. All I wanna do is to find a spot of land and live there with you. Someday we'll build a home on a hilltop high. You and I, shiny and new, a cottage that two can fill, and we'll be pleased to. The folks who live on the hill. Someday we may be adding a thing or two, a wing or two. We will make changes as any family will, but we will always be called the folks who live on the hill. A sort of view that seems to want to be seen. And when the kids grow up and leave us, we'll sit and look at that same old view. Just we two, Darby and Joan, who used to be Jack and Jill, and we'll be pleased to be called the folks who live on the hill.
Extended Bill Charlap finish. That was Sherie Rene Scott singing with Bill. That, of course, is a great, great song by Jerome Kern, lyrics by Oscar Hammerstein, an American classic. Well, let's return to my conversation with Bill Charlap over the phone, where he was playing a gig in Vienna, Austria, talking a little bit about the widening of the Broadway repertory.
Let me talk a little bit about how you find your repertory. I mean, you were playing some songs today that are from shows like Pickwick or Green Willow that people don't know but are also super-duper songs. Are these just songs that you pick up, or do you...
Well, in the case of a song like, well, you mentioned Green Willow, and of course you must be talking about Never Will I Marry.
Yes, fantastic rendition you did.
Frank Loesser.
Yep.
Yeah, and Frank Loesser, of course, was an icon of theater music, and he was my father's biggest influence. In fact, my father was one of the composers that Frank Loesser took under his wing.
Oh, wow.
And helped his career. Like Adler and Ross wrote, of
right.
course, Damn Yankees and Pajama Game, and some others. With that song, however, I must say I learned it from Nancy Wilson and Cannonball Adderley, their iconic version of it.
Fantastic.
But getting to know it then from the score of Green Willow is quite different, and it gets into another area of it. And in that case, that's me playing Never Will I Marry, ironically, with the love of my life, and that's Renee Rasmus. Of course, we're married, so... it's always a good way to start the concert.
That's a beautiful musical paradox, and a beautiful rendition of a great, great unsung, as it were, song.
Thank you.
what's the best thing for you, and the best thing for you would be me. I've been convinced after thinking it through that the best thing for you would be me. Every day to myself I say, point the way, what will it be? I ask myself, what's the best thing for you? And myself and I seem to agree that the best thing for you would be me.
That was Bill Charlap accompanying his own mom, Sandy Stewart, in a great Berlin song from Call Me Madam. This is Larry Mazon, your host for Broadway to Main Street here on 88.3 FM. And today we are spending an hour with the great pianist Bill Charlap, not only his music, but an interview I was able to conduct with him when a recent gig he was playing in Austria. So here is more of our phone interview with the great pianist.
You devoted separate albums to what you call the Mount Rushmore, Kern, Gershwin, Bernstein. Where do you, as far as
I put Bernstein on that list necessarily, but Bernstein is a very, of course, important American artist.
Right.
But he's not quite on the Mount Rushmore list. He's on another mountain, maybe right next door.
What mountain would you call that?
Mountain of Leonard Bernstein.
That's hilarious. That's
because,
great.
It's pretty interesting. You know, here's a guy who wrote symphonic works and classical music, probably all kinds of music like that, before he ever wrote a popular song.
Right.
As opposed to Gershwin, who wrote hundreds of popular songs before he ever thought of American in Paris or Piano Concerto, the Concerto in F, or Porgy and Bess. So they came from opposite sides of the tracks, but there's something about Bernstein, the way he amalgamated things, Gershwin, Stravinsky, Aaron Copland, Mahler, and the great songwriters, and that visceral, percussive, sometimes even violent, often very sexy, really gripping American theater music that he wrote, especially with Stephen Sondheim and West Side Story, and with Betty Comden and Adolph Green on The Town and Wonderful Town, which are so great. What? Richard Wilbur, too. Candide is marvelous.
I did a show, I don't know, half a year ago called Stealth Ballads, which were the songs that you forget that were on the, you know, they got surpassed by bigger hits. And your version of A Quiet Girl is almost Mozartian in its delicacy. I think it's such a great, great song.
I love it, too. And it is a very, it's very much almost an art song, you know?
Yeah.
It's a very interior type of song.
Thank you.
Let me talk a little bit about your collaboration with Sherie Rene Scott and David Yazbek. I had David on my show last week, and he sort of mentioned in passing, oh yeah, we recorded the song that was cut from the show. And I went, and we'll hear it in a second, downloaded it. It seems to me like the kind of thing that would have been written by Cy Coleman and Carolyn Lee and recorded by Wesla Whitfield or something. I mean, it feels like this missing cabaret gem from another parallel universe.
Yes.
How did you come to it?
That's a good way of putting it.
Yeah. How did you come to that song?
Well, the producer that I was working with, well, for many years I was working with a producer and recording engineer called Joel Moss. And Joel Moss recorded many original cast albums and is equally interested in musical theater as he is in all kinds of other music, jazz and folk music and all kinds of things. Joel mentioned that, you know, I've just recorded this, he was quite good friends with Sherie Rene Scott, and he said he had just recorded Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, and he said, you know, there's a song that would be nice as a bonus track if you played it with Sherie. And I went into the studio, I met Sherie then, and I took a look at the music and was put it through my own imagination harmonically, and it came out that way. And that's how that worked.
Beautiful.
Look at the way the moon behaves. Look at the way she paints a silver ribbon on the waves. One thing I've learned and I'll share with you. Nothing is too wonderful to be true. Each moment opens like a flower. The age of miracles comes every hour on the hour. Turn any corner, there's something new. And nothing is too wonderful to be true. If I'm perceived to be naive, to be the way I am, let people say I am a silly goof. Is life a plateful? Am I grateful? Every day I am. It's an amazing world in which we live, and I've got living proof. Look at the way the moon behaves. Look at the way she paints a silver ribbon on the waves, leading directly to me and you. Nothing is too wonderful to be true. You found your way back to the top. she paints a silver ribbon on the waves, leading directly to me and you.
Thank you.
Was Bill Charlap and Houston Person playing a wonderful song from Pickwick, we all know, If I Ruled the World. Before that, we heard a song cut from Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, performed by Bill and Sherie Rene Scott. This is Larry Mazon, your host for Broadway to Main Street. We're looking at Bill Charlap's contribution to songs from Broadway. If you want to know more about songs from Broadway, you can go on July 26th at Fridays at 5 at Bridgehampton Library, and I will be speaking about my most recent book, so come join us. Well, one of my favorite albums of all time is the Bill Evans, Tony Bennett album, which they recorded some amazing, amazing songs, and I talked to Bill Charlap a little about it and about his own work with Tony Bennett.
There's two of them. That's
yeah.
The one from Fantasy.
Right? Yeah, the yeah. First one. My guess is that album cast a long shadow for you, and you had the chance to work with Tony on your own. That would be now the second Desert Island disc I would bring along, the Look for the Silver Lining album.
Okay. Thank you very much. Well, of course, Bill's accompaniments are like Mahler songs. They're so perfect and so beautifully orchestrated and so personal. And Tony singing on both of those albums is really just the best of Tony Bennett. His real bel canto and getting also the story across so beautifully, and it's very interior, the intimacy of it. They're wonderful, wonderful albums. You know, I had a great teacher who was called Jack Riley, a wonderful pianist and composer and educator and theoretician, and he gave me a cassette. This was the first Walkman.
Wow.
It had four buttons, remember? The
right.
Four buttons?
Yeah.
And I had a cassette, and I'll never forget this cassette because it said Bartok number 3, piano and ORC, O-R-K. And on the other side, it said Bill and Tony.
Yeah.
So, and what it was it was together again. It was the second album
uh-huh.
on Tony's label, Improv, was on there. And it started after the Bartok Third Piano Concerto. It was Tony and Bill, and I remember walking around, you know, in my teens with a Walkman, listening to those and being knocked out. So, of course, they cast a large shadow, but only in the fact that they're so deeply inspiring, and to have the chance to make some music with Tony, certainly Bill is a part of my psyche forever anyway, and I neither tried to avoid it or not to avoid it. I just allowed it to come out where it would be natural and just be myself, essentially.
I want to be no one but me. I am in love with a lady who likes me the way I am. I have my faults. She likes my faults. I'm not very bright. She's not very bright. She thinks I'm grand. That's grand for me. She may be wrong, but if we get along, what do we care? Say we. Walking on the shore, swimming in the sea. When I am with her, I'm glad the boy who's with her is nobody else but me. Thank you. me. She may be wrong, but if we get along, what do we care? Say we, walking on the shore, swimming in the sea. When I am with her, I'm glad the boy who's with her is nobody else but me.
And there's nobody else like Tony Bennett and Bill Charlap. Make sure, fans, that you attend some of the Jazz in July at the 92nd Street Y. There are six concerts, July 16th, 17th, and 18th, and then again the 23rd, the 24th, and the 25th, with Bill Charlap behind the piano and artistic directing the whole thing. It's a magnificent way of loving the American songbook and jazz. And go to 92y.org for further information. Here's a wrap-up of my conversation with Bill Charlap.
We're going to end with some other time. Your magisterial rendition from your Bernstein album. I think I mentioned to you the first time I heard it. It was on, I was playing it through my car stereo on a CD. And I pulled over to the side of the road and wept because it was just so beautiful.
I was feeling a lot of things at the time that I made that record. And you know that some other time that Compton and Green are talking about is essentially just a wish, because there's not going to be any other time. That's it.
Right.
Pretty much. I think that's the undercurrent in the song. But I appreciate the word magisterial. That's how I felt in the song, and I think the modulatory sequence that I used, to not be too technical, but going from C major to B flat major and ending up in D major comes right out of Bernstein. And I love the sophisticated way that he gets from that final bridge to the last eight. That's pure Bernstein, and the way he's writing for the voices at that point, very contrapuntally in the score. All of that informed the way that I thought of the song. And it's an interesting point, because you brought up Bill Evans. You know, Some Other Time is one of those songs that has such a stamp. He made an iconic recording of it, not just with Tony, but also on Everybody Digs Bill Evans with, I believe, Sam Jones and Philly Joe Jones. So Bill's imprint is on that song very strongly, but I felt that that's another place where that could come through me, but it really was coming through in my own way, and maybe equally informed by Bernstein's harmonic angle and my own way of hearing that, and also somebody else who was very influential to my way of thinking, and that's Sir Richard Rodney Bennett.
Oh, God, what a hero. Yes. Of mine. What a hero.
Yes.
Well,
me too.
Every we've done 322 episodes, and our outro has always been Bill Evans and Tony Bennett playing Some Other Time. But Bill Charlap, I hope you and I will catch up some other time, and we're going to play out today with your rendition for the first time.
What an honor. Thank you very much.